Hello everyone, my name is Martino Stierli. I'm the Philip Johnson Chief Curator of Architecture and Design at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. For the first time in this virtual view series, I'm happy to say that I'm actually broadcasting from the museum, as you can see in the background. I am in the Architecture and Design Study Center, and I'm thrilled to be joined by our guest speakers tonight, Liz Diller and Mabel Wilson. Hi, Liz. And hi, Mabel.
Hi, Martino.
Hi, Martino.
Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We deeply regret we can't welcome you into the galleries, hopefully soon, but we remain grateful to have these opportunities to bring the museum and the art we care about to you at home. Tonight, we're going to speak about the great city we all love and live in, New York, and about some of the most iconic modern buildings and ambitious projects that define it from an architectural point of view. Both Liz and Mabel are architects and architectural thinkers who call New York their home. And they have not only contributed in many ways to how we understand the city, but they've also shaped the way we experience New York through their own projects. Before we get to our conversation about the architecture of New York City, I want to pause to welcome our amazing community of MoMA members and donors. Your support at this critical time and always means so much to me and to my colleagues, and we're delighted that you're here with us tonight. I want to first offer a special thank you to our partner Allianz for their tremendous support of architecture and design programs across the museum. If you aren't already a member, I hope you might consider joining. Your commitment to art and artists and ideas is incredibly important to all of us and makes possible much of what we do. You can do this online at moma.org/join. We have already received a lot of great questions from MoMA members over the past few days, but we also encourage you to submit your questions to us live. You can do so in the YouTube chat feature or send an email to membership@moma.org. Our producer will pass these questions along to me. Liz, Mabel, and I will begin with a short conversation and we'll turn to your questions shortly. Let me start with a few words on the topic of our conversation tonight, New York Open City. In the long months of the COVID-19 lockdown, many of us have found the city emptied of human presence and transformed into a place of eerie unfamiliarity. Based on this experience, we wanted to talk about some of our favorite and some of the most notorious buildings and projects that make up New York City. One aspect we are particularly interested in is the idea of the open city. How does architecture produce a sense of openness and permeability? And how do architectural features of openness provide a sense of accessibility, of a shared civic space, and thus embody the ideals of a democratic society? And finally, who gets to decide as to how open the city is for its citizens? These are just some of the issues and questions that we'd like to address tonight. So let's start with a look into one of our currently closed galleries. The center of the gallery is taken up by a fragment of the original glass facade of the United Nations Secretariat Building on the East River, and you can see the gallery view here. Glass facades have, of course, become a ubiquitous feature of our cityscapes, and it's hard to imagine what our cities might have looked like without them. However, the 39-story tower of the UN Secretariat Building, built between 1948 and 1952, is actually an important landmark in the history of glass architecture. From the early 20th century onward, architects had dreamed of buildings entirely clad in glass, but the UN Secretariat was the very first high-rise building in the US, and according to some accounts in the world, to employ such a facade across its entire height. We call this kind of facade a curtain wall system. Curtain walls basically consist of the repetition of standardized window units that are mounted on pre-assembled steel frames and suspended on the exterior of the building. And you can see that here on these two period shots by Ezra Stoller. And here is where I'd like to ask Liz Diller my first question. Liz, could you speak a little bit about why glass facades and the idea of transparency in architecture was such a fascination for modern architects, both in terms of aesthetics and of its political meaning? And how does this fascination relate to the idea of openness and institutional accessibility that we are interested in exploring tonight?
Okay, the glass stood for democratization of space. And it was very much a part of the ideology of the modern movement. And glass was, in this case, considered to be utopian. It introduced the technology of glass, high strength, long span glass, and curtain wall construction, meant a kind of liberation from load-bearing opaque masonry outer walls. So thus glass could produce a world without boundaries in which vision was unimpeded. And while it could produce this unlimited vision to the outside, the building also became transparent from the outside. So glass was in fact a two-way system. And it was considered a material of truth and a kind of instrument of disclosure. So the Secretariat, for example, was equated with peace diplomacy and lofty goals of glass. And it was this property that allowed the revelation of things that were otherwise hidden. So this transparent quality of glass exposed things that were normally hidden. And therefore, it became used as a representation of truth. So this technology, which promised disclosure, could also be used to display false appearances. So glass was no longer just invisible, it became a kind of screen. And, I wanted to mention that, you know, that this image that was just shown with Jacques Tati's playtime in the background, the one at the installation, this is one of my favorite movies of all time. And it was a kind of satire that portrayed glass as a voyeuristic, deceptive, and disorienting kind of protagonist in a very alienating and dystopian environment of 1960s architecture. And this character, Hulot, just bumbles his way through Paris, but Paris looks like any other city in the world. So the movie was ultimately a criticism of the Americanization of the French society.
I think that's precisely right, Liz. And I think that's one of the reasons why we wanted to juxtapose the UN curtain wall facade with that movie. And as you said, the use of curtain wall facades proliferated very quickly and became the hallmark of post-war architecture, particularly in buildings for business and government. And another prominent example of such a curtain wall that is contemporaneous with the UN Secretariat is the Lever House on Park Avenue, designed by the architects Gordon Bunshaft and Nathalie de Blois of SOM and built between 1950 and 1952. We're showing you here the spectacular model made by the professional model maker Theodore Conrad, as well as another iconic photograph by the American architectural photographer Ezra Stoller. So Liz, could you talk a little bit about the appropriation of architectural transparency through corporate culture and its implications for the public sphere in post-war America?
Is that for Mabel or for me?
Sorry, that's for Mabel. Sorry, Mabel.
It's yours.
Yeah, no, I mean, I want to maybe follow up a little bit on Liz about the paradox of both being seen and also, you know, the sense that the glass is also hiding and there are things that are not being disclosed. And absolutely, the curtain wall was, and glass, the technology was a symbol of modern progress, primarily because it also represented industrial manufacturing. So a very major shift in the processes through which building materials were also being made, which were no longer local, as with brick, for example, but also drawing steel, glass, gaskets. I mean, those were all beginning to draw from national networks of production, and as we know now, transnational and global networks of production. And so it served as a kind of ideal material and symbol for post-war American corporate culture, one that was beginning, as with Lieberhaus, to form, you know, which was already a kind of transnational corporation, but form organizational networks of capitalism and modern financial systems. And I would like to add maybe that while the post-war corporate skyscraper proclaims American cultural hegemony, particularly post-war, the growth of corporate economic power began to pose, I think, a regulatory challenge for the state, and thus for democracy, right, for the public sphere. And so as capitalism seeks more porous national borders, the idea of the public sphere becomes much more malleable and also under the control of corporate influences. So corporations begin to build modernist branches and facilities in other nations whose governments and economies have been made receptive by international policies of the IMF and the World Bank. So they're also within these emerging networks of corporate structures enabled through both financial, technological, and also cultural expansion. And certainly architecture is one medium that is traveling those circuits.
Yeah, Mabel, I think you're making a very important point that, you know, what we're talking about historically here actually has a great deal of relevance for our contemporary moment. And so Liz, in your own work as a practicing architect, you actually have often made use of transparency for a, say, contemporary expression of your architectural ideas. Most recently, you were in fact the architect of MoMA's latest expansion here on 53rd Street. And we have an image that speaks a little bit to the history of the institution. As a matter of fact, we can see in this press release from 1938 announcing the opening of the first purpose-built building for MoMA here on 53rd Street, vast expanses of glass were a key element of the museum's architectural design from the very beginning. So could you elaborate a bit on what transparency means for you in the museum and how it relates to the idea of openness and accessibility?
Yeah, so that press release and others like it were really very poignant. And they talked about the innovation of glass, and they talked about, very proudly about how many square feet of plate glass there was and how many glass bricks there were. And this new material called Thermalux, and which reduced thermal conductivity in glass. And this was all about technology and progress and modernism. And this was a very, very important highlight in the building. So when we came to MoMA as its next group of architects, we sort of realized that there was a great irony about, you know, the MoMA's original aspirations, and that MoMA was fairly opaque from the street. And we vowed to open up MoMA to the street for there to be a two-way vision, for MoMA to be more welcoming, a kind of extension of the publicness of the street. You know, it had been very cramped, crowded, and transactional. And so the intention was to make a kind of open, transparent public realm that bridged the two streets, 53rd and 54th, and art to the city. And we also felt, that the modernist project was unfinished in relationship to progress and technology and space making. And there was more work to do. For example, in the performance of glass on the stair that you see on the left, is a frameless glass that spans 23 feet. And each of those panes of glass is a structural beam. And this was impossible to do in the last century. And this was a very, very important for our expansion to have this moment of respite, you know, where you can look out and reorient yourself. We also felt, and maybe in the next slide, that typically galleries, and it was advertised in those original press releases that the galleries had glass, but in fact, curators are known to hate glass, and conservators are known to hate glass. It doesn't have the best effect on art, but it has many other very, very good effects. And So we found that MoMA was fairly close to the street, to 53rd and 54th in terms of galleries. And we wanted to reintroduce the notion of glass as an orienting system, as a means of connectivity between galleries. You could see on the right, and this is, we're standing in the same spot looking to in one direction and the other. And we see the use of glass in two different ways, internally and externally. And it's all about, being able to juggle external influences like sight and orientation and other things that are going on with a great experience of art.
And I do think that works very well. So congratulations once again on that. I'm interested in your, key interest in the advancement of technology that actually allows your architecture, your transparent architecture today. And that actually brings me to my next question for Mabel. So in your work as a historian and as a founding member of the advocacy project, Who Built Your Architecture?, you have explored questions of ecology and global supply chains behind the materials used in contemporary construction, including glass, among others, of course. We're showing you here a placeholder for this topic, a work by the German-born artist Hans Hacke titled Condensation Cube. So I was wondering if you had some thoughts on this.
I love that those the Hacke projects in which he is making us aware of the environment and the things that we don't see. But also the condensation cube also makes clear the differences between here and there, right? That boundaries of built things demarcate. And so it can also be about possession and territoriality, even through, as Hacke is pointing out, glass. And so glass enables buildings to be hermetically sealed, closed environments in some respects, but also I think exactly as both you and Liz have described, there's a kind of visual, right, accessibility as we see in the city behind you. But, buildings are also porous in other ways, and the ways in which they link to environmental systems, sewerage, HVAC, and those systems often breach that bounded condition in terms of the definition of enclosure and here and there. And so I think sometimes while buildings often feel that they're very much rooted in place, when we think about construction and how buildings are actually formed, materials like glass are part of immense supply chains that expand across continent and also rely upon unequal wage structures of labor and also labor conditions. They also tap into forms of resource extraction that contribute to global warming. So materials are very, very complicated, and I think they tell complex stories about, even though buildings are rooted in place, they're linked to these complex networks.
Yeah, but that's
I wanted to mention one thing, if I may, that in the context of speaking about glass sort of in a broad sense environmentally, I wanted to quote the Bill de Blasio ban on glass, because I was really interested in our discussion before. So he says, we are going to introduce legislation to ban glass and steel skyscrapers that have contributed so much to global warming. They have no place in our city or on our earth anymore. And it's interesting because of course it's true that that glass and sustainability and tall buildings, are all connected, and it's a very, very important topic. But the notion of introducing legislation to ban the glass and steel skyscrapers was just a very, very interesting formulation, which was totally ideological. And I think it's no coincidence that the glass is married to issues of power, privilege, waste, and all of that, and therefore there's this real anger around about glass.
Absolutely, Liz. So, and I think if we have another image that brings, maybe pushes this point a little further still. So Mabel, here's another picture that I'd like you to comment on, and you will maybe not recognize, this is actually the MoMA facade boarded up during the recent protests in the city. And many museums actually were boarded up and hit their public facing transparent entries. So what are your thoughts on this, perhaps also in light of what Liz just said?
I mean, it's very remarkable image, I think, in the ways in which, you know, the plywoodification of the city, which was remarkable if you were in New York to kind of watch the plywood go up, right? You know, especially always over glass facades of banks and stores. And it was quite remarkable because, you know, its transparency is producing a sort of condition of consumer desire, you know, of a kind of voyeurism that is so fundamental to urban life. And then all of a sudden there was a radical shift with this arrival of this other material, a very kind of crude material that then becomes a kind of backdrop for a whole other system of signification, right? That isn't often made visible. And in many ways, I think it's related to the haka. It's like these things that are not visible all of a sudden are emergent. And clearly with Black Lives Matter, it was about the emergent inequalities that are within the city that are also speaking through a kind of aesthetic project.
So let's now turn our attention to other architectural means than transparency and how to produce openness in the city. And we're using another historical example, namely the Seagram building by Mies van der Rohe, also on Park Avenue, built opposite the Lever House in the late 1950s, which is probably one of the most recognizable modern buildings in the city, or if at all. Like our earlier examples, the Seagram building, which was designed as the corporate headquarters for the Canadian distillers Joseph E. Seagram and Sons, features a pristine curtain wall facade. But what distinguishes this building from many other high-rises of the period is not only the exceptional care of its design and execution and the exquisite material palette, but also the fact that it is set back from the street and so makes space, literally makes space for an open and publicly accessible space, a plaza, on what is a private property. As we can see on this next slide, the granite plaza in front of the Seagram building is a beloved spot for many Midtown office workers, if they are in the office, and passers-by to sit down and enjoy lunch or a quiet moment. So Liz, could you tell us a little bit about the significance of this particular privately owned public space, POPs as they are called, a 1961 zoning concept particular to New York City, and how it set an example for how later projects provide publicly accessible space in a highly dense urban environment?
Yeah, so, I mean, it's interesting to understand that at the time that this building was being designed, the city zoning required tall buildings to set back from the street in a kind of ziggurat wedding cake fashion that would allow light to come down onto the sidewalk and street. The Seagram building was the first building to recede from the street, and creating that big open space, which was also a kind of plinth that reconciled the slope of the street. So if you go down 53rd Street or 52nd, you would see that, you know, that plinth gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It becomes a face wall of the building toward the east. Knowing the architectural bravado of Mies, I think the setback produced this forecourt for the building also to be better seen and admired, you know? So I think he was very, very proud of the building. And, you know, you can't really see buildings from the sidewalk. You have to step across the street to see them. So I think, you know, the success of the Seagram, as you mentioned, led to this 1961 zoning resolution, which offered incentives to developers to build something like 10 square feet of bonus rentable or sellable floor area in return for 1 square foot of plaza. And this is what was called privately owned public space. And it took on the form of plazas, arcades, small parks, atria, and so forth. And these POPs actually accumulated are about 80 acres of footprint. Wow. In Manhattan. And it's interesting to note, and Gerald Caden talks about this, that half of these were really of marginal quality. Half of them were non-compliant with legal requirements, resulting in privatization. So while this building was, you know, fantastic, trend-setting idea that changed the zoning, it wasn't, you know, entirely observed in the right spirit by developers.
So actually, we have a first question by somebody from the audience, Paul Beza. Thanks for your question. I'm going to read this out. While seemingly open, many of the places in the city discussed are also subject to all kinds of real and virtual policing and surveillance. How can architects address that in their design approach? Is that something you wanted to respond to, Liz?
Well, I do think that public spaces are very, very important, you know, to all of us, and it's very important for all of us to be vigilant about making sure that they don't get privatized. So that's very, very important. But I also would say that institutions, lobbies of institutions, like MoMA, for example, but many others, you know, are effectively extensions of the street and public, and could be made public, more public for opportunities that arise, like, you know, the protests that we've been, you know, part of in the past couple of months. These spaces, like the streets and like the official public spaces that are sort of sanctioned and paid for by public money, are also part of this extension of public space. And I think architects really should be sort of part of an effort to secure as much public space as possible, because most of it is being gobbled up by developers.
So this is a good moment, I think, to turn to another historical example where that has happened with more or less success, but definitely a lot of contestation. And I would like to turn to so-called urban renewal from the 1960s. The project that I would like to pull up allows us to shift the perspective away from that of the architect who basically imposed their ideas on the city and instead take on the point of view of the users or the citizens for whom urban spaces are created and provided. We're seeing here the Lincoln, an aerial of the site of the future Lincoln Center. Liz, your office has worked on the Lincoln Center on the Upper West Side in recent years. Could you tell us a little bit about how this massive urban renewal project from the early 1960s triggered an activist response in the city, and how this response became an important force in subsequent conversations on how, on who, rather, on who gets to decide what is actually built?
So yeah, so there are many, many good things about Lincoln Center and an equal amount of not great things. So Lincoln Center was a pioneer in bringing all the performing arts onto one campus, but this was hotly disputed as it sort of centralized the arts and made an exclusive enclave rather than dispersing arts throughout the city. And, but this was a kind of, it was masterminded by Robert Moses as an urban development project and part of the mayor's committee on slum clearance. So in order to curb the rapid change of racial demographics in the city, that is the flight of the middle class to the suburbs and the vast migration of Black and Puerto Rican immigrants to the city, to the center of the city, the government began to heavily employ the powers of eminent domain. And basically, you know, responsible for threatening this 16 acres of space for so many residents and businesses. And maybe go to the slide, you know, there's the slide of the original architects. Yeah. These guys. So very high testosterone group of architects, including Philip Johnson, Wallace Harrison, Saarinen, Eero Saarinen, Bunshaft, Abramovitz, and you see John Rockefeller also there, who's a great philanthropist and very had a lot of power. So there, you know, I should just mention that Rockefeller, I understand, requested like even more clearance, which would basically take down a bit of constructed area between Columbus Avenue, Broadway, and Central Park West to have a clear view across Central Park from the Fifth Avenue triplex to the Met Opera. This is what I've understood in some readings I've done. But there was, you know, there was a lot of sort of masterminding there between like really good intentions and also some pretty scary ones. But there was resistance. Can you show the next slide? So yeah, so there was this, there was a lot of resistance. This came all the way up to the Supreme Court, but you know, ultimately the fate of the demolition of the neighborhood was pretty much sealed. So next slide. So those 18 blocks of city were dismantled. You could see some of the residents. This is the beginning of the demolition. And these were primarily Black neighborhoods. You know, when we come back to Lincoln Center, when we arrived there, we looked at, you know, some of the basically urban, this mega block thinking, you know, these urban miscalculations that were made at the time that were, you know, mid-century, they were characteristic of mid-century, but our aim was more social. It was to transform the campus and make good on the publicness of Lincoln Center's public spaces without, you know, necessarily being able to afford a $150 ticket to the opera. And that was, and we did this sort of breaking down that fortress and that rarefied domain for the arts, just breaking down the walls, creating more transparency, more porosity, and exchange between public spaces and municipal space of the street.
So let's talk a little more about this removal of African American communities. And we actually have a very interesting project, maybe the last one we can discuss tonight before we switch to the audiences. So let's show the, so here is actually Robert Moses that you just invoked and Jane Jacobs, of course, who was fighting these big urban renewal projects. But let's move on to the Skyrise to Harlem instant slum clearance project, which is perhaps a little less known project for a large scale urban transformation. Which was presented to a large audience in Esquire magazine in April 1965. And you're seeing a page spread from this feature here. So Mabel, you've actually written about this project and done research on it. The project illustrates an alternative strategy of how to increase density in the city without necessarily displacing existing communities on the ground. Could you elaborate a bit on the significance of critical projects like this?
I mean, I think it was important, and this is in the mid-1960s, for June Jordan, who was using a nom de plume, June Meyer, when they submitted the project to Esquire, and Buckminster Fuller, to kind of maybe rethink exactly the problems that Liz was identifying in San Juan Hill, and the power of someone like Moses to not only cut through the lower East Side that Jane Jacobs protested, but also cut across spaces like the South Bronx. And so that white flight was enabled by massive dispossession and displacement in often poor Latinx and Black communities. And so within that context, I think Jordan and Fuller in their Skyrise to Harlem sought to really harness the power of industrialized housing production while remaining attentive to social and natural ecologies. And so these insane like eco towers were populated with shared amenities of social services, and they would sprout literally from the bottom up, right? So they would draw from the community up into the sky. So a different kind of high rise, a sky rise. And it would be built by the Black community to preserve social relations and Black social spaces that were typically destroyed by urban renewal, or what James Baldwin called Negro removal, but also opened the area to settlement by other non-Black residents, which was a really important, I think, notion to sort of lob into the massive production of both public housing as well as the suburbanization that was going on in the New York metro region.
We actually have a question from our very own Evangelos Kotsioris, who is a curatorial assistant in the Department of Architecture and Design. Thanks, Evangelos. And here's the question, which actually relates to what you just said, Mabel. New York City is often synonymous with its skyline of skyscrapers and glass towers. Yet, for the majority of New Yorkers, an open city might in fact mean access to affordable housing. In what ways can architects contribute to this end, if at all? Who would like to answer this question? Liz, what do you
Mabel?
Think?
Well, you know,
it's a tough question. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, architects, I think with all the best intentions, really need the support of cities, municipalities, and capital. To really invest in those kinds of projects. And, you know, real estate is very expensive in New York, as we know. And that's why it's becoming more and more unaffordable. And gentrification just keeps, you know, making the city harder and harder to actually live in. So yes, there is a need for affordable housing. Architects will do and can do what they can, but we need the space, the locations, the capital, the investment, the developers, and all of that. Mabel, I don't know if you have
thoughts. You know, I think precisely what we've been trying to sort of illustrate is the entanglements of architecture, that buildings are never singular, but are enmeshed in all kinds of relationships that allow them to come into being. And we're in a moment where there's just vast inequalities, where 10% of the country owns 75% of the wealth, which leaves 90% basically dependent upon declining income. And, you know, and that's producing a kind of literal physical landscape that is grossly unequal in terms of the amount of space one lives in. Like, people were already socially distanced through wealth, even within the city, with the amount of square foot. And those who couldn't socially distance, which is why, you know, the Black and Latinx communities in New York City were hit very hard by the pandemic, precisely because of those literal inequalities that are now structured into how we live in the city.
We actually have an interesting follow-up question that ties in well with the Skyrise to Harlem project that you were describing before, Mabel. And, you know, one of the interesting features, I believe, of this project is that it was actually supposed to be kind of like a hanging garden, right? Every apartment had a terrace, and then so there would be vegetation outside. It's actually a very radically contemporary idea. And so here is a really interesting question by Caroline Aguilar-Dubose. Can you speak to community gardens and their contribution to public open space? Community gardens.
I mean, I find the history of community gardens in New York City absolutely fascinating, because many of them certainly formed in neighborhoods that had been disinvested. And so, you know, it was a form of activism of simply taking over the city and providing a kind of social space, a public space for a community to engage in all forms of activity. But it also provided a kind of connection often with practices that were coming from African-Americans moving into neighborhoods, and also people migrating from elsewhere, from the Caribbean, you know, who already had traditions of provisions and plots that were made to grow food nearby. And so I think they actually provide a kind of activism that starts to, that have kind of rooted communities in place, but also brought them into a kind of discourse around public and around the future of neighborhoods in the city, in ways, you know, that often aren't accounted for in the ways that Jane Jacobs' very visible activism.
And actually, just another question, it's a live question that just came in this second, maybe that's something for Liz. The question is by Olivia Schneider, and she asks, are POPs only in Manhattan? Are requirements for public space equitable across the city? So I guess the question is, do these things also exist in other boroughs outside of Manhattan?
I actually don't know the answer to that. I understand it as being a Manhattan zoning strategy, and it really has to do with areas around Midtown, you know, where these issues are really relevant, and where these bonuses are, there are deals that are struck between open space and the tallness of a building, and zoning. So as far as I know, it applies to Manhattan.
Yeah.
But I want to say something about that. You know, I want to ask Mabel whether community gardens are, what percentage of community gardens are safeguarded? What percentage of them that, are in between, let's say, holding a plot of land and then developing a plot of land by an owner?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, I don't know the statistics at all. I mean, I'm not in any way an expert on that question, but I've always found them fascinated in terms of the ways in which, because a lot of what we're talking about is really governed by the regime of property. Architecture is really underlaid by who actually can possess land and who can control it. You know, so there are clear power relations. So the ability to basically re-territorialize land that is not yours, right? And to claim it, right, for social activities, to kind of claim it as a quasi-public sphere, I think is remarkable. And that this occurred long before the notion, the hipster notion of the urban farm, right? And so these were often, spaces where, kind of practices of farming, that were coming from elsewhere were sort of rooted in place. And I just find that really a kind of remarkable history that has actually disappeared with gentrification and projects of redevelopment. And I know there are scholars and activists who actually do, phenomenal work trying to retain those spaces within the city, because they're certainly under threat.
So here's another question for both of you, and it's a tough one. So I'm curious to hear what you think. The question is by Dan Ansel. So what do you see as the largest missed opportunity in New York in terms of designing for public space?
Go for it, Liz.
Well, okay. I mean, I'm just going to tell you what I really, really, think from the heart. While I was the shed, and I'm very proud of the shed as a new cultural institution, it sits in Hudson Yards, and I feel that Hudson Yards was going to be developing a park amid of the various buildings on the surrounding edges, on the periphery of the site, I feel like that would have been exactly the right thing to do, a public park that maybe brings the sort of vision down to the level of the canopy of trees, because you're surrounded by gigantic towers. I think that the notion of building an Instagrammable tourist attraction was a decision made by the developer that I think was, it's extremely popular, but questionable in my mind.
So here's another set of questions that relate to more recent additions to the skyline. And the first question is by Marilyn Borometti, who has been a member with MoMA for 15 years. Thank you so much, Marilyn. So the question is, what is the group's opinion of buildings in Manhattan over 75 stories high, what I call alien buildings? And then just a live question by Ron Caldwell that fits in very nicely with this topic. What is the projected lifespan of buildings like 432 Park and the structures of Billionaires Row? So Mabel, what do you think? What is your opinion on these mega tall buildings?
They really do throw the scale of the city out of whack. I'm always astonished crossing Central Park and just seeing that massive shift in scale. I mean, I was walking along 57th Street, and they all are starting to look the same. I mean, there was literally a kind of atmospheric condition. I mean, it was like it was in within an air chamber or something. I mean, they're very strange, but I call them space deposit boxes. I mean, I think it's a kind of a way in which finance is banking space, right? Offshoring monies into space that I, again, find highly problematic in relationship to that earlier question around affordable housing. Like, people are banking space. They're banking it within our high, you know, within our shared public sphere of the skyline. And I think it's very questionable.
So what about lifespan, Liz? Can you talk to that?
Well, I don't know about the lifespan. You know, I suspect that these are going to be at least 50-year buildings, but, you know, there's, in the next generation of technologies, we're going to be able to build 200-story buildings and 300-story buildings. Who knows? You know, I guess, you know, just to respond a little bit to that point of those high-rise residential towers that Mabel is talking about are mostly vacant. You know, I mean, if they were populated, if people were living in them, it would be less objectionable because, you know, there would be some density. The problem is that we're building high and we're building thin on small properties. And actually these are, you know, yes, there were safe deposit boxes in the sky and they're not lived in. I would say that, you know, Manhattan is the idea of the city and the sort of masses, the height of Midtown and the height of downtown. You know, there are these sort of mounds of that are basically composed of high buildings, tall buildings. And adding to the skyline of those tall buildings is, to me, okay, as long as it's planned, you know, with the sort of concept and the design of the city in mind. But when these, you know, skinny towers are popping up in low density, low rise blocks, that is unconscionable to me, you know, when they're just singular. And so, you know, I think we, you know, we have to face up to it. We're going to be building more, and the FAR of Manhattan is hardly used up. There's a lot of building to go, and there's going to be a lot more density before we know it. But I think as long as it's calculated and planned, you know, with good city planning, it could be okay. You know, and that's what we, you know, what we saw in the early part of the century with the stepping back of buildings. There was a kind of consciousness of the shadow of a building and, you know, its relationship to the next building and the next. And so I think we need to bring urban planning back, you know, as a really a fundamental necessity to the city.
Absolutely.
And we've lost sight of it.
Here's actually another live question by Tashi Poo. So they are wondering if Mabel or Liz have any thoughts as to what might be a more sustainable and actually transparent alternative to the skyscraper and how that might affect the future of urban planning. Any thoughts on that? Some an alternative to the skyscraper as we know it.
I mean, I agree with Liz. I mean, a skyscraper is like financial instruments. Like it's not even architecture. I mean, there's a certain, you know, there are algorithms and, you know, there are all these ways in which they just calculate how we can maximize profit from the construction of these things. And so that people can literally park their cash in these structures without ever having to live there. That's why, you know, space deposit boxes. But, you know, I think that we need other kinds of models. And I don't know if it's possible in the financial, you know, the kind of capitalism that has evolved is not really around life, it's around accumulation. I mean, capitalism is, well, certainly that is the project, but, you know, I just feel like we need, fundamentally, my position is we need to be different kinds of humans together. We need to find ways, maybe the Enlightenment project of democracy, of which architecture is a part of, is failing. And so what kinds of models of building, of ideas of possession of land, of property, of material that can be just profoundly more ethical? And I think it's going to have to be a complete recalibration of how we live. I mean, there, you know, my colleague Saidiya Hartman, it just talks about we have to like abolish capitalism. We have to think radically different about our social relations if we're going to survive as a species. And that's a large answer to that question. But I think that's really where we get the work done. And it's tough.
You know, and when we think about what the future holds, you know, And I'm just going to put COVID aside because I am hoping that it'll blow through sometime, you know, as soon as it can, and that it's not going to have a long, long lasting effect on the desire to live in cities. But, you know, if we look pre-COVID at the way that populations are growing in cities, we know that cities are going to just get more and more dense. And so what do we do? You know, we could think about mid-rise, you know, that we have low-rise, we have, you know, we don't have a lot of mid-rise. And I think that there's some territory there. And the problem that I see is greed, you know, and greed of developers, of property owners. I think that the sense is to sort of, you know, optimize the site and the property to sell it and get out quick. Rather than, you know, to really think about a city as a long-term project of investment, you know, for the next 50 years when you do a development, next 100 years, and invest in that. And so you don't get your money in return right away, but you actually stick around to improve all sorts of public amenities and to sort of stabilize cities so that they're not just, you know, poor and rich enclaves, but really integrate and really do good on sort of bringing populations together and you know, to make a better and more diverse city. But I think that it really has to do, the problem has to do with greed, and it has to do with lack of city planning you know, it's a governmental problem and it's a developer problem. And I think it could be solved.
So since you just invoked the pandemic, there's two questions from the audience, and perhaps we can just very, very briefly respond to those. The first is by Laura Lalinde. The pandemic has decisively changed the ways in which many of the open spaces of New York City are used these days, from parks to sidewalks to whole streets fenced off for pedestrian use. Do you expect that these temporary measures might have a long-lasting impact on the way civic space is designed? So that's the first question. And the second question is by Jabeli Rodriguez. What are the largest difficulties in designing within a post-pandemic world? What do you think, Mabel?
I do think that the pandemic does bring up a serious question, not just about cities, but also about urban expansion. Because a lot of what's been happening, I mean, you know, the novel coronavirus, it's just the new coronavirus. And so this is happening against SARS, MERS. I mean, this is, and it has a lot to do with the encroachment of human settlement on other ecologies. And that's part of the problem. And so I think, you know, building smartly and more ecologically, globally, I think could begin to think through and solve some of these problems. I mean, I saw an extraordinary image on the New York Times today about the Hajj in Mecca, and it showed a photograph of what it typically looks like.
Yeah.
And then there's this other image that it's extraordinary. I mean, it's completely choreographed with umbrellas of specific colors around now how that space has to be occupied. And I think it's simply, you know, it's a question of how smart we are as humans to understand our impact on our environment that will continually cause us to readjust our sort of everyday behaviors. And so I don't think this novel coronavirus is the only one, and it clearly hasn't been. It's just been extraordinarily contagious and destructive.
Now, you know, on the really, really sad side, you know, if one really thinks about this as having long-lasting effect on the way we plan and design. Cities are cities and they're great because of density, right? I mean, it used to be that density was a bad thing, actually. And that's what led to, you know, the TB and the concerns of, you know, of contagion sort of led to people fleeing cities. You know, when that got under control, cities started to become actually more resilient. I mean, it's scientifically proven that people who reside in cities actually are more resilient to disease. But it's also a challenge to all of us to think about how we can, maintain some of the very best things about cities, which have to do with being together, which have to do with the density and being able to go to a theater or a museum and be in places of public assembly. The short-term fix, I think, is using the fourth dimension of time, and that's what I think a lot of us are thinking about, how to de-densify by simply using 24-hour clock. We think about time as, work time as 9 to 5. Well, in a global marketplace, it's a 24-hour kind of condition. And so why not really think about, those shifts that we think of as night shifts as just a continuum of time. And that's one way, perhaps that we can de-densify some of our most beloved spaces.
Unfortunately, our time is almost up. And I was going to ask you both, actually, as my last question for tonight, what your thoughts are on the future of public space in the city. But I feel in a way we've kind of already answered that. But Mabel, maybe just a couple more sentences. What are your thoughts? Are we going to have public space in the city, and what is it going to be like?
I would just say that with the Black Lives Matter protests, as complicated as they have been, particularly in relationship to policing, that they show me that public space still matters, that the public space of contestation, of the polis, of the vibrancy of a need to engage in politics, the public comes from this notion of the polis, right? So it really is about politics. And so, and that these are happening all over the place in small towns and worldwide, as Jelani Cobb has called it, the American Spring. So is that, we actually still do have a very vibrant public sphere, even if it's under threat by various forces.
Well, on that note, thank you so much for joining us this evening. If you weren't able to catch the whole show live, this will be up on MoMA.org for viewing immediately after the stream ends in just a minute. We've had viewers tune in from all over the world. People are joining us right now in Maine, Chihuahua, Mexico, Steventown, New York, Seoul, Korea, Florida, Buenos Aires in Argentina, obviously New York City and Brooklyn, Montreal and the Philippines, and I'm sure I'm leaving some other places out. Remember, you can stay up to date with everything that's happening at the museum on magazine and at MoMA.org, where you'll find much more information about New York Open City. And be sure to tune in for our next virtual views live Q&A with Rajendra Roy, our chief curator of film, who will be exploring treasures from MoMA's film collection as part of Film Vault Summer Camp with filmmaker Todd Haynes. I really appreciate all the help from my colleagues across the museum who have made all of this possible, and thank everyone again for tuning in. Be well, and we look forward to seeing you at the museum as soon as it is possible to reopen. Good night.